Good morning.
My name is Alex Rack. I use he, they pronouns, and I'm your worship host today. Welcome to White Bear Unitarian Universalist Church. We are a community of youth, adults, and children of many diverse theologies held together by covenant, not creed. Together, we share the values of courage, reverence, and compassion. May you know deep welcome and belonging in this place. To share a request for today's meditation, please place it in the chat box before the opening hymn or add it to our meditation bowl. Please gain consent before the use of someone's full name. The meditation bowl is in the Soulwork Center. Welcome any visitors. We are so glad that you are here on this Labor Day weekend. Let's give a wave to all who are watching online. Hello, online friends. For those in the room, please join us in our social hour after the service in the social hall. Welcome to our church. Together, we grow our souls and serve the world in love.
Well, it's good to be here. Please join me in the call to worship. And I don't have these words in front of me, but I remember most of them, and I trust that you do too. Come in. Come into this place which we make holy by our presence. Come in with all your feelings and fears, strengths, loves and fears, hopes and anxiety. Anything other than who you are and who you are called to be. Come into this place which we make it holy place. And so we do with our errors too. Thank you for your grace.
My name is Teal, and my pronouns are she, her. I have a vivid memory of my beloved ballet teacher explaining to my class how to master a very important skill for any ballerina, balancing on one leg. It is a big step for a young dancer to move away from the bar to the middle of the room and be able to gracefully arabesque without stumbling. My teacher had a wooden box with two pegs inside that she held up for us to see. As she set it on the floor, she took the pegs out and balanced the box on top. So the pegs were like little legs for the box body. She pulled one peg away. The wooden box noisily toppled to the floor. How can I keep the box balanced on just one peg? She asked. We were all entranced, thinking it surely was impossible. She set one peg up and placed the box on top of it. Right in the middle, the box balanced. You see, she said, the most important thing about balancing is to shift the weight of your body over your standing leg. If you can master the skill of shifting, you will remain balanced. We all stood up and practiced standing on one leg with a newfound understanding of how a ballerina maintains such graceful balance. I'm trying my best to stay balanced these days, but just recently I was stumbling a bit. Some of you know that I started taking classes with a goal to start a new career. Unfortunately, after one semester, I realized that this was not the season for me to take on school full-time, work part-time, and maintain my household and children. I decided to put my schooling on hold for the time being. Sometimes I feel I failed at reaching the goal that I set out in front of me. But it was only a step back because I was stumbling, exhausted, and overwhelmed. My balance was gone. I stepped away from the bar too soon. I was unable to shift the many heavy weights in my life. I know that there will be stages where life feels solid and easy, and other times when nothing feels solid and easy. I'm not sure I know the answer to why this is, but maybe it has to do with the fact that our lives are always shifting, moving. Sometimes we haven't mastered how to balance everything, and some things are going to be more important to hold, and other things will have to be dropped because the weight is too heavy to shift into balance. I'm lighting this chalice today to acknowledge the wobbly young child learning how to shift their weight to balance, to dance, and the lifelong practice of understanding what it means to be balanced while stumbling, shifting, and never staying the same. Please rise in body or spirit and join me in the opening words. Love is the spirit of this church, and service is its law. This is our great covenant, to dwell together in peace, to seek the truth in love, and to help one another. Please remain standing as we turn to the gray hymnal, Singing the Living Tradition, to sing song number 12. O life that maketh all things new.
Good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
This morning I'll be filling in for the story for Matt. The story that I'd like to share with you this morning is about curiosity and wonder and how sometimes you have to imagine what is not yet possible before you go about proving it is possible. It's a true story based on a telling by Gail Forsyth Vale, about one of our Unitarian faith ancestors named Charles Darwin. I invite you this morning to take a breath and try to imagine yourself into the story, exploring, wondering, and imagining right along with Charles. From the time he was a young child, Charles Darwin was an explorer. He left to roam the fields and hills near his home in England. He was fascinated by the movement of small animals and insects and knew each wildflower by name. He was curious about everything, and he saw and heard and touched, wondering at the lives of ants and butterflies. He examined and collected rocks, delighting in the grasses, trees, leaves, and flowers that provided homes for his very favorite creature, the beetle. Charles was given a great gift by his two grandfathers. It was the gift of curiosity. Both of his grandfathers were Unitarians, and they believed that human beings did not yet know all the answers to life's great questions. Because of this, they instilled in him a willingness to challenge the current understandings of our world, because they knew that there were many questions and mysteries that had not yet been fully answered. They thought that the clues to these mysteries were to be found by observing the world around them, by asking questions, by listening, and by wondering and imagining. And so Charles practiced observing. His observing led to more questions, more wondering and imagining about the whole wide world of things yet to be known. When Charles was 8, his father sent him away to school, wanting him to learn Greek, Latin, and ancient history. Instead, Charles spent his time outdoors observing, wandering, imagining. He would spend hours watching the intricate workings of an anthill, then hours more as he considered the fascinating mysteries found in rock piles. At every opportunity, he took long walks outdoors, watching, listening, and collecting. He delighted in figuring out how creatures behaved and how the natural world worked. When Charles was 15, his father sent him to medical school to become a doctor like his father and his grandfather before him. But Charles found that he yearned to be back outside. Charles wasn't alone. He found friends who also felt at home in nature and would teach him all about different kinds of plants. Charles began to draw these plants in great detail, labeling the parts, learning to tell one variety from another. 2 years later, Charles left medical school. It was clear that he did not want to be a doctor. Instead, his father sent him to university to become a minister. In those days, it was not unusual to study to be a minister and study science. Charles planned to find a small church in the countryside so he could spend most of his time observing animals, rocks, and insects, and drawing those plants. But Charles soon discovered that while he loved learning all kinds of things, his work would be as a naturalist. When he was only 19 years old, he was invited to spend 5 years traveling around the world on a ship called the HMS Beagle, serving as its naturalist. His job was to draw and make notes on plants, animals, and rock formations everywhere the ship went. On that trip, Charles began to piece together clues to the great puzzle then called the Mystery of Mysteries, how all the different forms of life on Earth came to be. As he traveled, Charles filled notebooks with drawings and notes. He wondered and asked questions. He listened, he observed. He imagined and stayed open to the curiosities of the natural world as they presented themselves. Frogs, salamanders, armadillos, insects, and lots of fossils. When he returned to England 5 years later, he understood how plants and animals evolved from one another over the course of many, many thousands and millions of years. 22 years later, Charles published a remarkable book called The Origin of Species. Charles Darwin, the collector with a gift of wonder, a spirit of adventure, and openness to new ideas, had become the scientist whose theory responded to the mystery of mysteries. But the story doesn't end there. Just as Charles's work was inspired by the wondering of and imagining of others, Charles's work then went on to inspire others to observe, ask questions, and listen and wonder. And these new observations led to more questions, more wondering, and more imagining about the whole wide world of things yet to be known. And it still continues today. I hope that all of us here today can continue the spirit of curiosity and wonder, remaining open to new answers to life's questions and mysteries.
Before we begin with the meditation, I will just introduce myself. Some of you know me, some of you don't. My name is Karen Herring. My pronouns are she, her. I was ordained in this congregation in 2008. Thank you very much. And it is a joy to be home with you. And will you pray with me? Holy One, source of all being and promise of all our becoming, we gather today in the unsteadiness of our times, on the shaky ground of all that is changing in our personal lives, in our shared congregational lives, and in our wider faith. And with so much shifting in our communities, our nation, and our world, and the earth itself, we especially lift up our nation's elected leaders today and those running for election as they seek a new path through this troubled time. In the midst of so much quaking change, it is natural to hold on even more tightly to what we wish would stay the same. Still, gathering here and online today, let us also name a hope that we might learn to let go. Maybe even to fall a bit, dropping into the presence of the sacred, into mystery, into our better, diviner natures. So may the gift of this hour shared together move us in heart and spirit and mind into relationship with one another and with the wider world. May this be the balance restored by our gathering. May this be the balance we bring to the world. In the name of love, we pray. Amen. Each week as you gather here, you attend to the concerns and hopes carried in all of our hearts. And today, I want to lift up a note from Sue left in the meditation bowl, saying, please hold in your hearts and prayers my daughter who has a very serious health condition. Let us, in a moment of silence, also name those we carry in our hearts. If you wish to speak them out loud, please do. Please type them in the chat if you are with us online. And we will hold these for a moment of silence. May all those whose names were spoken and those who remain carried silently in the sanctuaries of our hearts receive peace and strength and love from this moment of prayer. Amen. Our next hymn is, let me find it.
Be thou my vision.
Thank
number
you.
20 in the Great Hymnal.
Thank you.
Few announcements before we take this morning's offering. Please note that our Water Communion Sunday will be taking place at 10 a.m. next Sunday, September 8th. Also, the first time that I have the opportunity to direct the choir here, so something to look forward to. Do be advised that is the last Sunday of the summer with only one service. And that'll be at 10 a.m. Please be sure to bring some water with you from some special place in your life, whether that be your travels, your tap water, or your garden hose. We will co-mingle the water together in our meaningful annual ritual on that day. And please also take note of the backpack blessing taking place the next week, September 15th. Whether you are starting a new school year or a new job or a new chapter in life, we want to bless you on that journey. Please bring a bag or a backpack so that we can bless it and you on that day. We're also looking for a few volunteers that would be willing to help run the book stall on Sunday mornings. Contact Anne Galloway Eggie, thank you, if you're able to help. Each week, we practice gratitude and support in the form of giving to our offering plate. The gifts collected today will go to support the mission of this congregation to grow our souls and serve the world. There are a couple of ways you can give today. You can use the text to give feature. The number is in your order of service. You can give on the website, or you can place cash or a check in the offertory basket. However you choose to give, thank you for your generosity and your faith in this life we live together. The offertory will now be gratefully collected.
Thank you.
Our first reading, From Learning to Fall by Philip Simmons. My earliest memory, I'm standing alone at the top of the stairs, looking down, scared. I call for my mother, but she doesn't come. I grip the banister and look down. I have never done this on my own before. It's the first conscious decision of my life. On some level, I must know that by doing this, I'm becoming something new. I am becoming an I. The memory ends here. My hand gripping the rail above my head, 1 foot launched into space. 40 years later, encroaching baldness has made it easier to see the scars I gained from that adventure. Still, I don't regret it. One has to start somewhere. Is not falling as much as climbing our birthright? In the Christian theology of the fall, we all suffer the fall from grace, the fall from our primordial connectedness with God. My little tumble down the stairs was my own expulsion from the garden. Ever after, I have been falling forward and down into the scarred years of conscious life, falling into the knowledge of pain, grief, loss. Think again of falling as a figure of speech. We fall on our faces, we fall for a joke, we fall for someone, we fall in love. In each of these falls, what do we fall away from? We fall from ego, we fall from our carefully constructed identities, our reputations, our precious selves. We fall from ambition, we fall from grasping, we fall, at least temporarily, from reason. And what do we fall into? We fall into passion, into terror, into unreasoning joy. We fall into humility, into compassion, into emptiness, into oneness with forces larger than ourselves, into oneness with others whom we realize are likewise falling. We fall at last into the presence of the sacred, into godliness, into mystery, into our better, diviner natures. Second reading, Ecstasis by Lucy Shaw. The music Gustav Holst, The Planets, is described by the announcer as moving, touching, powerful. As if, even as we listen, we'll get shoved around, displaced, our senses orienting us onto something other. So maybe this is what is meant for us, to be ready to be unsteady. Unhinged, beside ourselves, constrained by magic, to know the world new, to be transposed, dislodged, ready for realignment, reintegration. Bring it, what it takes for sight, for hearing, touch, taste, sense of smell, spirited imagination, any of the ways we're engineered for transformation.
Thank you.
I want to begin with an excerpt from a poem by Tomura Ryuichi, post-war Japanese poet. And it goes like this. The poem rests on a single line, barely. A kind of balance of terror. Humans must hold out our arms and endure this balance. A moment's dizziness will tilt our whole lives. Whether or not you have ever done tree pose or star pose, as I have just tried to do in my shoes, you probably have known moments like that when the balance of your life tilted, perhaps causing dizziness or discomfort, disorientation or disequilibrium, or exhilarating joy. I am surprised how often when I do star pose and tilt like that, I automatically smile. Your own tilting moment might have brought relief or joy, or as the poet puts it, a kind of balance of terror. Maybe it came with a pink slip announcing the end of employment, or a love letter calling your heart out of hiding. It might have been a phone call naming a diagnosis unwanted, or bringing news of a long-awaited cure. In the poetry of our lives, our balance can be tilted by the terrible or the terrific, each with the capacity of creating a moment's dizziness in which to wonder in terror or anticipation, who am I now and what am I to do next? In addition to the events of our personal lives that might shift us off balance, we are collectively in this nation living through a significant time of teetering and tilting. I don't need to tell you that. Historically in the US, we have been living on high alert for centuries due to the threats at the core of white supremacy and the violent premises of any nation founded on enslaving and denying the humanity of whole groups of people. And in recent years, this long-held, long-ignored high alert around racial oppression has been heightened by the imbalances of pandemic living and by the growing forces working to destroy the guardrails of democracy. I don't for a moment want to discount the pain, anxieties, and powerlessness of becoming unsteady. But I do today want to suggest that being off balance is often required if we wish to move and grow and change ourselves, our nation, and our world, which is one of the reasons groundlessness is such an important concept in spiritual teachings and life. In one of the readings we just heard, Unitarian Universalist Philip Simmons describes his first experience of groundlessness with that story of the childhood tumble down the stairs. And despite the scar that came of it, he says he had no regrets. Is not falling, he asks us, as much as climbing our birthright? It is no small thing to note that Simmons wrote this essay as his response to the diagnosis of ALS, or Lou Gehrig's disease, that he received at the age of 35. Learning to Fall, as he titled the essay and the book that contains it, was part of a larger lesson in living with that debilitating disease that first robbed his legs of strength and later ended his life tragically early. It was a spiritual lesson that he summed up this way: only when we let go our grip on all that we find most precious, our achievements, our plans, our loved ones, our very selves, can we find ultimately the most profound freedom. In the act of letting go of our lives, he said, we return more fully to them. So when Simmons talks about falling, quote, from ego, from our carefully constructed identities, our reputations, our precious selves, from ambition and from grasping, end quote, he is talking about things we normally cling to as if they are certain, as if they are necessary for the good life we want to lead and sometimes for the good work we hope to do. He names the gift of letting go of these, whether we are falling into illness, into another change in our lives, or into the grief of extraordinary loss. He is talking about letting go and falling into uncertainty as the first step into relationship. It might be a wobbly step, probably unsteady, but as we let go, we move beyond the boundaries of ego into compassion, into mystery and wonder, and as Simmons puts it, into the presence of the sacred and our better, diviner selves. Groundlessness, it seems, has much to offer. If we can tilt with it, it can bring us some of the greatest gifts of spiritual living and spiritual growth. So when we come together on Sundays as Unitarian Universalists, as we are today, perhaps it's not solid ground we find with one another, but the gift of groundlessness. We come not seeking a stationary balance, the balance of standing still, or of ideas and dogmas carefully stacked into position, balanced to keep from tumbling as history marches on. No. As we did in General Assembly last June with the vote on Article 2, we Unitarian Universalists regularly ask ourselves, what are the values we hold in common, and how have they been deepened and refocused as we have grown spiritually and in diversity and understanding? It is no small thing, friends, to be a faith built not on creed, but in covenant with one another. In our free faith tradition, the balance we find and offer is a balance in motion. A balance that involves some waving of arms and hands, sometimes wild and clumsy, and sometimes graceful. A balance of relationship, one that points to the larger questions and demands, as the poet says, that we hold our arms out and suffer a moment's dizziness as our lives are tilted toward one another and toward a future we have not seen or known before. This is what art does too, isn't it? The way an extraordinary painting can reveal a new horizon, or the way good literature or fine movies and theater sometimes offer us an ending we never saw coming. Or as Lucy Shaw's poem describes, the way a symphony like The Planets by Gustav Holst can shove us around and dislodge us, send us spinning with music so muscular it could move the planets themselves. And thank you, Mary, for bringing some of that music to us today. The first piece Mary played was from The Planets, and I appreciate that. And the piece before this sermon was very muscular and emotional as well. Thank you. Good art and good worship both are meant to move us, to move our hearts and to move our lives toward the open-hearted postures of love and wonder, toward transformation, toward a new and deeper peace within and well beyond us. What does that mean in an era that is so full of change? It sometimes feels every day is pushing us around, dislodging us with dizziness. It's not always easy, is it? This is why I wrote a book about this titled Trusting Change, which names 10 skills for not only enduring the unsteadiness of change, but also making use of that unsteadiness to shape our lives and our world in new ways aligned with our values, our hopes, and our dreams of healing, our dreams of beloved community. You can get a copy of the book in the bookstall today, I think, or in the future. This is what it looks like. And I understand you'll be invited to join a discussion group based on the book sometime this fall. And I'm not here today to either read to you from the book or to summarize it. I'm here today to pay witness to what inspired it, to the trembling uncertainties of our time, and to encourage all of us to make use of that unsteadiness and to do that rebalancing together. Life now insists that we encounter groundlessness, writes the organizational guru Meg Wheatley. Systems and ideas that seemed reliable and solid dissolve at an increasing rate. She said, strategies that worked suddenly don't. Sound familiar? Groundlessness, she said, is a frightening place, at least at first, but as the old culture turns to mush, we would feel stronger if we stopped searching for solid ground. If we sought to locate ourselves in the present and do our work from here. The German activist Rudolf Barrow once said, when the forms of an old culture are dying, the new culture is created by a few people who are unafraid to be insecure. Are we willing and courageous enough to be insecure? Are you? Am I? Is this perhaps the balance that we find and keep in our Unitarian Universalist congregations? The balance of groundlessness? The kind of balance of a creedless covenantal religion, a balance of movement and relationship, a balance much needed now as our old culture is dying and a new one has yet to be created. Perhaps this is what is meant for us, writes Lucy Shaw, to be ready, to be unsteady, to be unhinged, beside ourselves, constrained by magic, to know the world anew, to be transposed, dislodged, ready for realignment, reintegration. Think about it. To be beside ourselves is to claim a new center that sits beyond our ego. To be ready for realignment is to open ourselves to a new order. To be transposed is to place ourselves in a new arrangement with others, or to let the melody we are playing to move into a new key. When I was young, I played the clarinet. When I was 17, I was both thrilled and terrified when my clarinet teacher invited me to play the first clarinet part in the Fox Valley Symphony's performance of Ravel's Bolero. My first experience performing in a real orchestra under the baton of a professional director. Two performances were scheduled. On subsequent nights in the Grand Performance Hall at Lawrence University, and my clarinet teacher would sit next to me playing the E-flat clarinet part in Bolero's work. Now, some of you might know the clarinet part in Ravel's Bolero is not particularly difficult, but it is radically exposed. The piece begins with a rhythm from a single drum and the soft plucking of violas and cellos. Bum, ba-da-da-dum, bum, bum, ba-da-da-dum, bum. You've probably heard it. Several measures later, a single flute comes in with a wandering melody, which is soon handed off to the clarinet as the only instrument playing the theme for almost a full minute. Da 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 dum ba da dum. You've heard that. On the evening of our first concert, I sat nervously on the edge of my chair, clarinet to my lips, my eyes trained on that conductor. The drummer began from the back of the stage, and as the flute solo neared its end, the conductor's eyes bore into my own. And then, in the split second before my solo began, I lost my place. I lost my footing, my solid ground. Just like that, I lost the beat. And the room began to spin, and I missed my cue. To my horror, the first measure of my solo passed in silence with only the drum and the plucking of the violas and cellos, and the conductor's face knotted in an angry grimace. I hastily drew a breath and jumped in two measures late. After the concert, the conductor said nothing to me. He called my teacher to the side for a terse exchange, and later my teacher told me the conductor had forbidden me to play the solo in the next night's concert. I could play the lead part for the rest of the piece, but the opening solo was to be played by my teacher, who would bring both his E-flat clarinet and his B-flat clarinet. I was crushed and relieved. My teacher, however, had another idea. I was to spend the entire next day practicing my entrance. And then in the concert the next night, at the beginning of the piece, my teacher would raise his clarinet to his lips, but on the conductor's cue, I would be the one to come in and play. Perhaps I don't need to tell you how this terrified me. Some of the most unsteady ground I have ever known in my life has been the ground that breaks up, shifts, and slides like an active avalanche after my own failures. I begged my teacher to play the solo, but he refused. That evening, my hands were shaking as the concert began and the conductor raised his baton, nodding at my teacher. No one noticed that I had raised my instrument to my lips too, but when the conductor's baton went up, I came in exactly on cue, building volume for that first long note of the solo, while my teacher lowered his clarinet to his lap, and the conductor looked from my teacher to me with great anger. Then, realizing he had no choice, he offered me the slightest of nods, and I snaked my way. I almost said shaked. I snaked my way very successfully through the rest of the solo and the song. I have to say, I did not goof up at the beginning of this service. according to this theme. That was truly a mistake, too. Friends, we are living in times made unsteady by innumerable mistakes and failures, many of our own doing. We have all missed many cues. Collectively and individually, we have often not come in when we were and are most needed. We have failed to protect the earth, the poor, the children of this world, the marginalized. Those of us who are people of privilege in its many forms have time and time again failed to speak out against the systems that advantage us and oppress others. We cannot engage in the work of social change, of challenging white supremacy and patriarchy and any embedded system of oppression without a willingness to fail and to keep trying. Are we willing to try again and again, to feel ourselves falling, to acknowledge our failings, and even so, to let go of our fears, our egos, our certainty of how things should go, of what should have been done, long enough to let ourselves be moved back into action, into compassion, into new arrangements, to move back into relationship, first and foremost with ourselves, and then with others, all of us falling, all of us so unsteady in the challenges and the chaos of our times. Years ago, when our only child, Kat, who came of age in this congregation, when Kat graduated from college, my husband David and I sat in the sunny stadium bleachers, squinting at the thousands of graduates filling the field below in their matching purple gowns and mortarboards. Their faces were so small in the distance, and though we tried, we never did find Kat in the crowd. But after the students assembled, the college president stepped up to the podium and asked the graduates to turn and face us in the stadium. And the crowd of witnesses that were assembled there for them. And as the graduates turned toward us, the president then asked us to stand too. And I felt the eyes of the young graduates scanning us, looking for their people, just as we were looking for ours. Next, the president asked the graduates to applaud their loved ones in gratitude for our support. And then the president asked us in the stands to applaud the graduates in recognition of their accomplishments. And as we stood there applauding one another in the bleachers and on the field, all of us gazing into that sea of faces, looking for the ones we could claim as our own, it would have been difficult not to be moved, not to see that in fact in every face on the field there was someone who belonged to every one of us in the bleachers, and that every one of us in the bleachers was rooting for every one of them, each of us at every age tilting with uncertainty toward a future that we could not know, a future we would all have to make and claim and save together. In that moment, I felt my eyes, my ears, my whole heart opening to all of them, to all of us. I was beside myself, unhinged, my senses oriented to something other, something larger, something sacred that inspired the deepest wonder. Bring it, what it takes, says the poet, for sight, for hearing, touch, taste, sense of smell, spirited imagination, any of the ways we are engineered for transformation. Maybe this is what is meant for us, here in worship today, In the music and poetry that we share and hear on this or any Sunday, and in the discussion groups that you will have in this congregation, reading my book, Trusting Change, and other books as you go, letting wonder and relationship tilt our lives as we tumble into new arrangements, reaching out to one another, arms wide open, enduring this new balance. Maybe this is how we learn and teach one another to be ready to be unsteady, to keep falling with open hearts into mystery, into wonder, into the presence of the sacred and our better, diviner selves. May it be so, and amen. The hymn is Life Calls Us On. It is printed in your order of service.
Go ahead and rise in body and spirit and sing boldly, even if it's less familiar to you.
Guides and love and through thee.
friends, may our longing for solid ground be met by the blessing of a steady and moving love. Let us hold out our arms to one another. Go ahead. Hold them out to one another. Let us endure the unsteadiness of this time by being together and experiencing the joy and the steadiness of love and of a faith that moves and grows. Go in peace and with love.